Two, while you're doing that, I want to just make a comment. I understand you're probably used to it, the number of young people and folks who are on the platform and playing instruments, using their talents and abilities God has given to them to help in the worship service of our church. But you need to understand that doesn't happen everywhere. What the folks up here are doing and the young people singing and all of that, that doesn't happen in every church. I wish it did. And young people, I commend you because when you're up here, we have little ones who watch you and you're being an example to them. And I'm thankful for that. And I want you to understand you carry influence. I know it's an awkward time of life. And we struggle with different things as a teenager, but I want you to understand, the little ones look up to you, and in many ways, you are heroes to them. And so I'm appreciative of you wanting to sing and play and be a part, be in the choir, play instruments, whatever the case may be. And adults, it ought to be a conviction to us also that we ought to use our talents and abilities for the Lord and certainly join in with them in that. And there are several adults that do, and so it's not a rebuke by any stretch of the imagination, just being thankful for what God has done and how He has blessed this. We're blessed what God has given to us, and so let's never take it for granted. Let's foster that and continue to grow that, and certainly thank you for your prayers in that. If you found Acts 2 in verse number 41, if you'll stand if you're physically able, and we'll read this passage of Scripture, a familiar passage to many. But I wanted to kind of start a series on Sunday evenings on the search for church and what is a church? What should we be a part of? Or what's our purpose? What's our drive? And that's kind of what we're starting tonight is what is the purpose of us being a church? Why are we here? What do we do? Why are we weird and meet on Sunday morning and Sunday night and Wednesday night and all of those kind of things? You know, why do we have special meetings and why do we give money to missions and all of those kind of themes? So Acts 2, look at verse number 41. Then they that gladly received His word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they, that's those that were saved and baptized, those in the church, continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in breaking of bread and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul. And many wonders and signs were done by the apostles, and all that believed were together and had all things common, and sold their possessions and goods and parted them to all men as every man had need. And they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God, and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Now, Lord, help us, please, to understand the purpose for us being in a place called the church. Help us to understand what our role is, and, Lord, how we ought to live out or flesh out this thing we call Christianity, this personal faith that we placed in Christ. What does that look like as a church body lived out in the world that we live in? Help us understand that, and, Lord, not just understand it or to hear it and say, wasn't that nice? Lord, help us to do it, and we'll be, again, thankful for helping us to do that, because we can't do it without your power, without your strength, without your help. And Lord, we love you. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for standing. You may be seated. The more you get into church and the more you've been in church, you understand that people have vastly different ideas about what the purpose of the church is. There are some that would come into a church and it's, well, that's where I meet my friends. I mean, that's, you know, we hang out together at church. Other people say, well, that's where I do business, and I have business contacts there, and I do a lot of business in the church. Or, man, our church is to meet the needs of the community and do what we can to just, you know, feed the hungry and clothe the poor and all of these social activities that we're just surrounded by on a daily basis. Some believe it's a place, just solely a council for families, or this is the place where there's a million different things. This is the place where my needs get ministered to. That's a big one. What does this place have for me? But the question, that's a different question than the Bible question for what the purpose of the church is. The Bible answer or purpose for the church is, what does God expect me to do through my local church? Not what is the church supposed to do for me? What benefit does the church have for me? The question that's brought up, or the subject that's brought up in the scripture, is what am I now? Because I'm saved, because I identify with the church, what now am I supposed to do in my local church? What's my role? What should my involvement be? Do I just sit and soak? Or do I get saved and baptized and then get involved somewhere? Do I look to meet other people's needs? Do I look to serve instead of being served? All of those things we're going to find in Scripture. This first church at Jerusalem, we see its foundation in the book of Matthew as Christ picks out those 12 first apostles and they grow into this church, and now they're in Jerusalem, and Peter preaches this tremendous message in the first part of Acts chapter number 2 on the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. This church at Jerusalem, they displayed what the purpose of the church is supposed to be. What does God want us to do? Now that we've trusted Christ and now that we've identified with Him, what are we now supposed to do? Well, this church at Jerusalem gives us a great example. And I think there's three things that we're going to see in our study here of what the purpose of this first church in Jerusalem was. And by the way, it ought to be the purpose of this church at 2305 Forbes Drive in Austin, Texas. We ought to be doing the same three things. All right? So what are the three things? Thank you for asking. Number one, we ought to love God. We ought to love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Part of the purpose of this place being on this property, God bringing together this group of people, is so that we would love Him. So as we love Him, then that brings number two. It gets into then growing together. We love God and then we grow together closer to Him and closer to one another. I'm a firm believer that my closest friends ought to be the people in this church. Right? Now, I ought to and I should have friends outside of this church, because I shouldn't just isolate myself and become like a monk or a hermit and say, well, my only friends should be saved people. That's not found anywhere in the Bible. How am I supposed to witness somebody if all my friends are already saved? It doesn't make sense, right? So I ought to have friendships or relationships outside of the walls of this place, but my closest relationships ought to be right here within these walls. Because we have a common Savior, a common love for Him, and as we have that common love, then part of the purpose of the church is we grow together. So we love God, we grow together, and then third and finally, we're going to see it in Acts chapter number 2, and as we go through this study, we're going to see that their third goal or their third purpose was to then serve others. Right? I love God, I'm growing together with my church family, and then as an outpouring of that, as I grow in my Christian walk, then I look to, it ain't just about me, it's about getting out there and serving other people. Right? One of the best ways that I serve other people is because I've been given the truth, I get out there and I share that with them. The truth of their sinfulness and their need of a Savior. But that's not the only way that I serve. Right? I can serve by offering a helping hand. I can serve by prayer. I can serve by feeding those that are hungry. I can serve by clothing those that are needy. I can do a lot of different things, but it's not just doing things to make myself feel better or look better, or to make our church have a great name. No, it grows out of my love for God and my growing together with other Christian believers in my local church. I grow then to serve other people. So we're just going to look at number one tonight, and not to cover all three of those. Just look at number one, that kind of the first purpose right here in Acts chapter number 2. Our church should focus, first of all, on loving God. All right? That ought to be our driving emphasis in this place. And I'm not trying to be silly with it, but I'm not certain, I'm not sold on that a lot of Christians know what that really means. What does it really mean to love God? What does it look like when I love God? How does that play itself out in my life? I exist, you exist to love God, and we gather together in this place to express our love to God. In both the Old Testament and the New Testament, the Lord commands us to love Him above everything else. Right? Here's two examples. Deuteronomy 6, verses 4 and 5. Here's what the Bible says. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, with all thy soul, with all thy might. Right? Old Testament, it says Israel, it can be applied to us. How do I know? Well, because listen to Mark chapter number 12, verse number 30. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. By the way, when you look at those 10 commandments that were given in Exodus chapter number 20, you understand that, and Jesus does this in the New Testament, He breaks them down really into two commandments. Right? I'm supposed to love the Lord my God with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. If I love Him with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength, guess what? I'm not going to have any other gods before Him. I'm not going to make any graven images. Right? If I then love my God, I'm supposed to love my neighbor as I love myself. Well, if I love my neighbor, guess what? I won't take his stuff. Because it's his stuff. It ain't my stuff. Right? I'm not going to covet what my neighbor has. Right? I'm not going to bear false witness against my neighbor if I really love him. Do you understand how those things translate into those Ten Commandments? Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And so, just part of a healthy church relationship is growing in my heart attitude, my heart relationship with God. That's the foundation of how I walk. So, I'm growing in my walk with the Lord, and by just commonality, I'm going to grow in my walk with fellow believers. Right? As I get closer to the Lord, I get closer to fellow believers as they're growing closer to Him. Right? I use this in marriage counseling or premarital counseling. Right? I'll have people, the husband and the wife, or the groom and the bride, I'll have them write on a piece of paper, and I'll have them write God at the very top. And then there's two little lines coming out from God, and then on one end I'll have husband, and one end I'll have them write wife, and it's just a visual image for them to see, okay, as we get closer to God individually, we're drawing closer to one another, right? And it's the same thing with the church. As my fellow church members are drawing closer to the Lord, you see, we're getting closer to one another, right? And that's what this church in Acts chapter number 2, that's what this first church in Jerusalem is a picture for us to do also. People go through different motions of serving God, of loving God. They serve God for a variety of motives, but only true love for God is going to sustain lifelong growth. Right? If I say I love God, but I don't really in my heart, you understand that's not going to last very long. My service for Him is going to dwindle and die off. Because I'm really, if I'm not doing it for God, I'm really doing it for me. Well, when enough people don't pat me on the back, I start to kind of wane in my service. Because I was really looking for praise for myself and not serving God. All right? And so, let's look at some things here. Number one, this love for God commences or starts at salvation. All right? When we truly worship God, you first have to know Him and have a personal relationship with Him. So, okay, the word worship. Don't let the charismatics or the Pentecostals or any other group, don't let them take that word worship. It's a good Bible word, all right? And what we think in our mind of worship, we think of, boy, a light show and a rock band and, you know, a music leader in skinny jeans or whatever people do now for worship, all right? That's not worship. All right? Worship, the biblical term worship, literally means to prostrate yourself, right? To humble yourself or to lower yourself, right? This could be worship if I'm bowing my knee before a holy God, right? Humbling myself before Him is worshiping Him. So if that's the case, is a song service alone, is that just how I worship God? No. I can worship Him in song service. But you understand, I can worship Him. I can prostrate myself, humble myself before my God and worship Him in my time of daily devotions. Because I humble myself before Him. I realize I don't have all the answers. Neither do you. But He does. Right? He has the answer for every important question that I could ever ask. And so I humble myself. I worship Him by coming to Him and saying, okay, I don't have the answers, but He does. And so I'm going to spend time in His book. Right? Can I humble myself or can I worship God in a time of prayer? Yes. Yes. I would humble myself. By the way, prayer ought to be me realizing that I have a need that I cannot meet. See, if I can meet my own needs, why do I need to pray? I can meet my own needs. That's why sometimes we struggle with, we don't pray as the Bible example is, give us this day our daily bread. Because we've got 7 days worth of daily bread in our pantry. You know, we already have it. Well, I did that. I mean, I worked for it. You know, I went down to HEB or grocery store and I paid for it. No, God gave you that. But if I don't humble myself, if I'm not worshiping Him, I'm not placing even proper priority on what He's given to me. Right? He's given me everything. He gives me life and breath. And so I have to understand, at salvation, this love for Him begins. All right. Look at Acts chapter number 2. Look again at verse number 41. Look at how the Bible describes this group of people who heard Peter preach on the day of Pentecost. Acts 2:41. Then they that what? Gladly received His word. They did it with cheerful hearts. Hey, we were lost, and now because of what this message, the truth of this message that is preached, I understand that I'm a sinner. I'm wicked before a holy God. But because of what His Son has done, He offers to me grace. And so what these did is they realized, okay, I know. That resonates with me. The Holy Spirit began to convict them of their sin, show them their need of a Savior. And then they gladly received the word that was given to them. Their love for God began at that point. He preaches this message, and Scripture tells us that thousands that were there, that heard this message, believed on Christ in one day. And salvation provided security for these people that nothing else ever could. There's nothing that the disciples, nothing that anyone could have given these people that would give them any more security than what Jesus gave to them. Listen to John 1, verse 11. He came into His own. This is Jesus Christ. He came into His own, and His own received Him not. But as many as received Him, to them gave He power to become what? The sons of God. Even to them that believe on His name. So when I'm saved, I'm not just forgiven of my sins, but I'm placed into the family of God. I'm made to be a joint heir with Christ. In other words, what is His inheritance becomes my inheritance because I'm a good person. No, because He is good. Right? Because of the work that He has done, He enables me to be a child of the King. It's not because of you. I love you, but you're rotten. How do I know? Because I'm rotten. How do I know that? Because of the truth of the Bible. And it tells me who I am before Him. And so when I get a fresh vision of Him, just as Isaiah does, I have to bow on my knees and humble myself and worship Him and say, woe is me, for I am undone. I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell amongst a people of unclean lips. What do You want me to do now that I realize who You are and who I am? Lord, what do You want me to do? That ought to be my natural reaction. And my love just grows in that way. John 10, verse 27. You have probably heard these verses. I use them often when dealing with people about eternal security. Listen to what the Bible says. My sheep hear My voice, and I know them, and they follow Me. And I give unto them eternal life. By the way, how long is eternal? Eternal. Forever. I give to them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of My hand. What a great promise God gives. Jonathan Edwards, one of the great preachers of yesteryear, was part of what God used to bring about that first great awakening on the American soil. Here's what he said: true love begins with God and loves Him for His own sake. Self-love begins with self and loves God in the interest of self. See, if I just love myself, then I'll try to love God in order to get something from Him. And I'll live my Christian life in this, if you scratch my back, I'll scratch your back, kind of a way or a relationship. And that's not the relationship that God wants to have with me. All right? I don't love God or give service to Him or in some way try to draw closer to Him so that He will do something for me. All right? I don't serve in ministry. Ministry is not, what do I get out of it? What benefits is this going to give to me? Well, I'll serve in the choir, but what's that going to do for me? What reward is God going to give me because I blow my mouth on a tuba? Well, probably He's not going to give you a winning lottery ticket if that's what you're looking for. All right? There are better blessings than millions of dollars. All right? I know in our way of thinking, it's hard to think, are there? Yeah, there are. All right? My love, I don't try to love God again in this way that it's more for me than for Him. God loves me and has promised. He said He will take care of me. When I'm acting good, when I've left my cares at the altar and I am free of any sin, there's nothing that is causing any guilt in my life. I've confessed my sin and I'm living clean for God. Praise the Lord. Man, God loves me right here. Okay, but what about Tuesday afternoon when the boss yelled at you and the kids are screaming in the back seat and you're ready to tear your hair out? Does God love you here? Yes. Yeah. Yeah. And not because I love Him more over there or love Him less here. See, His love for me isn't based on me. It's based on Him. Praise the Lord for that. Man, when you start to realize that, that lifts a whole burden off of your shoulders. Because you realize, man, I don't have to try to work up God's love or God's care for me. God doesn't say, well, but I wish I wouldn't have saved them. He never says that. All right? He loves you. Take your Bible to 1 John chapter number 4. I want you to see this. Hold your place in Acts 2. Look at 1 John chapter number 4. 1 John 4, find verse number 16. And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. I love that statement. We have known it. We have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Herein is our love made perfect. Notice that we may have, what's the word? Boldness. Boldness when? In the day of judgment. Wow. You know, most preaching is trying to get you scared of the day of judgment. Trying to get you to serve God in some way so that your life won't be replayed on the big, well, when I was a kid, VCR in heaven. Now I guess it's a Blu-ray player. If you don't do right, then your whole life's going to be played before you. That's not in the Bible. Okay? In fact, the Bible says in 1 John chapter number 4 that because of God's love, I can have boldness in the day of judgment. Why? Because I've already been made perfect. It's not based on, well, he got hit by a bus and he said a curse word right before it, so, you know, I guess he has to spend some time in purgatory. That's not how it works. All right? I'm saved because of what Jesus has done. All of my sin has already been washed away. Praise the Lord for that. So then I can, when the day of judgment comes, I can have, because of God's love for me, I can have boldness in the day of judgment. Why are you here? Because of what Jesus Christ did, not because of me. Man, what a relief. Notice, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no, I love this, there's no fear in love. Glory. But perfect love does what? Casteth out fear. Because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. Oh man, we could park there for a while. We're not going to, but we could. So our relationship to God, our service to God, usually takes one of three forms. One, we usually serve God out of fear. Right? I'm afraid of God and what he will do to me, so I'm going to serve him and try to stave off his judgment on my life. That's not good motivation. Right? Number two, we serve God sometimes out of obligation. Well, that preacher just spits and yells and tells me I'm supposed to do something, so I guess I better do it so he gets off my back. That's not a good motivation to serve God. But third, according to 1 John chapter number 4, and the best motivation for me and you to serve God is out of love. I love him. Why wouldn't I want to serve him? Boy, he's done much more for me. I can't repay him. But because I love him, I want to serve him. Because I love him, I want to play the piano for congregational singing. Because I love him, I want to go out and minister to some shut-in's needs. Right? Because I love him, I want to go change somebody's tire that needs help. Because I might be able to share the gospel with them. Do you understand how that works? Because I love him, I want to pray for those that are needy and struggling with something. The Lord doesn't want me to render service to him out of fear, but out of love. It's a joy to grow in my love for him, which begins when? At the moment of my salvation. I love him because he first loved me. And when I understand his love, then I can properly love him. Because I wouldn't understand what the proper definition of love is apart from Jesus Christ. Apart from Christ, you understand how the world gets their definition of love? You may have one of these in your home. It's called a television. And I'm telling you, there's a lot of people that learn what they think love is off of the television. Or off of the movie screen. Or what they see other people doing. Let me just say this. That's not love. Okay? You know where you best learn the definition of love is in that book. Because Jesus Christ the righteous showed you and me what love really is. Right? He gave his life for me. He lived the perfect life in my place. So then I can love him back. That's what he wants from me. That sounds like a pretty good deal. He wants my love. He wants relationship. So it begins at salvation. Number two, it continues with identification. So these Christians, now back to Acts chapter number 2, these Christians, they trusted in Christ, and then they desired to identify with Christ and with his church. Look at Acts 2 verse number 41 again. Then they that gladly received his word, that's they were saved, were what? Baptized. Right? They're identifying with Christ. They understood this is true salvation, and now they want to identify with that decision or make that decision public through baptism. Baptism identifies us with Christ. That biblical pattern of baptism, it's the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not salvation. It's not adding additional grace to me. It's me identifying and saying, yep, that's what Jesus did for me. I'm identifying. I'm saying, I've already put my trust in what he has done for me, and I want everybody to know about it. They identified with their belief, with this doctrine that they had been taught, this truth, so to speak. Romans chapter number 6, verse number 4. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. So what is baptism? Baptism is just an outward picture of what's already happened in my heart. Right? Tyler, come here. Yeah, come on. I know. You don't want it. It's all right. People are waiting, man. This is my wedding ring. Right? This tells the world, I'm off the market. Can't have me. All right? So, Tyler, are you married yet?
No.
Good. Amen. All right. Good. That's good. You know what Tyler could do? He could go down to the jewelry store. Now, don't do this. Please don't do this. All right? He could go down to the jewelry store and he could buy one of these them here rings. And he could put it. Let me see your finger. He could put it on his finger. It fits. Amen. He could walk around and say, and make everybody look at his ring, all right? And try to make everybody think, yep, I'm pretty cool, I'm married. Are you married?
No.
No. See, just because he got a ring on his finger doesn't mean he's married, all right? But if you're married, do you think you ought to wear a ring? Yeah, that's a good answer. Yes, yes. Now, give me my ring back, because that's, I don't want you to stay. You know, yeah, I want my ring. All right. Just because he has a ring on doesn't mean he's married, right? Just because you get baptized doesn't mean you're saved. By the way, it doesn't have any part of salvation. What this ring does is it signifies the decision that I've already made to this woman. That's my woman. And this is my ring to show you that's my woman. I'm already taken, right? And she better wear her ring also. Because she's taken, right? She's made the decision, and I made the decision when we stood at an altar and said, I do. We're signifying to everybody else, look at what I did, right? It doesn't make me married. I'm already married. It's just a picture to everybody else that I'm married, right? So baptism is. I've already made the decision to trust Christ. This is just a public profession. It just identifies me as being saved. It's a way for me to identify not just with Christ, but also with His local church. By the way, baptism is a step of obedience to the Lord. Right? If I want to obey the Lord, what do you think I ought to do? I ought to do what He tells me to do. And so part of what He tells me to do is to be baptized after salvation. So if I haven't been baptized scripturally, how should I, why can I expect God to bless or to try to answer my prayer or to lead me further in my understanding of Him if I'm not following in the very simple things of obedience? I'm not going to give you any more if you're not obeying the first things. Okay? And that's what these people are saying. I want to be obedient to this Savior that saved me. I want to show my love to Him. I love Him and I want to identify with Him. And so the way to do that is through then baptism, through their local New Testament church. It identifies me with Christ and it does identify me with the church. When these newly saved in Acts 2 were baptized, they're identifying with the doctrine of the apostles, the body of believers who were already in place. They were already in a manner of fellowship with one another in Jerusalem. Now they may not have had a physical building, but they're functioning as a church. They were added to the church through salvation and baptism. All right, and so all that they're doing is they're obeying, they're being obedient, they're showing their love to the Savior by identifying with Him. By the way, it's God's plan, according to what His book says, for all born-again believers to be involved in a local New Testament church where the Word of God is preached and taught and where there's opportunity to grow in their love for God. That's God's will for your life when you get saved. I've talked to people recently who have said, well, I'm a Christian, but I don't believe you need to go to church. Chapter and verse, please. Show me where God said that. Because God told me everything He wants me to know. He's already told me that I'm not supposed to forsake the assembling of ourselves together. So where in between there did He change what He said? You understand? Don't try to get cute with God. God's already given you His direction, His instruction. Right? He tells me I'm supposed to be involved in church. Loving God starts at salvation, continues with identification, third and finally, and we're done. It's cultivated then through my worship. I can worship the Lord privately. We come together as a church and worship corporately. But the best times when we would worship corporately are when you and I have worshiped privately well with our God. See, I shouldn't expect to come and worship corporately in it to just, man, that was tremendous time in church if I haven't been worshiping privately first. Right? Sometimes, I have heard the statement, you probably have too. Well, the song service in a church prepares our heart for what God has in the preaching. Okay, well, time out. Shouldn't I already come with my heart prepared for what God has for me? And then the song service ought to be an outflow or an outpouring of my heart that's already been prepared to worship God. Right? For me to humble my God instead of, well, I got to get warmed up by two or three good songs before I can really be ready to worship. What a terrible view. All I'm doing is showing the shallowness of my spirituality because I didn't take time to worship my God privately so that I can worship Him properly corporately. Now, the Bible tells us of two women who loved the Lord, but they were off balance in their worship. And I want you to see it, and we will be finished right after this. Luke chapter number 10. Luke 10, look at verse number 39. Many of you know the story. Luke 10, verse 39. Everybody there? Luke 10, 39. She had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard His word. But Martha was cumbered about much serving and came to Him and said, Lord, dost Thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore that she help me. And Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things, but one thing is needful. And Mary hath chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her. Was Martha a good woman? Yes. Yes. No, there's no question about it. Was Martha busy serving the Lord? Yes. Yes, the Bible is very clear and says that she was. As she served the Lord, did she do it with an agitated spirit? Oh, got a little quieter on that one. Yes. Yes. See, she's busy serving the Lord, but she did it with an agitated heart. She's not doing it with a right spirit or a right attitude. She's not worshiping because she loved the Lord as much as she's worshiping or serving rather to get some love for herself. All right? How do you know that? Well, because of her reaction to the Lord. Right? She's frustrated because in her mind, other people in the house weren't as concerned about the service, or she perceived, again, in her mind, that other people didn't care about anything that needed to be done. They knew there was a need, but they didn't really care about helping out or serving anything else. And what Martha does in Luke chapter number 10 is Martha begins to treat herself and sets herself up as the judge and jury. Now, time out again. Who's sitting in Martha's house? Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the judge of all the earth. He's the one that tells her what's right and what's wrong. And she determines, because her view isn't any bigger than herself, she comes to the Lord Almighty who gave her life and breath and says, Lord, don't you care? Don't you care that what I'm doing and no one else is jumping up to help here? Because Martha's care was about Martha. Martha's biggest problem wasn't that she had too much to do. Martha's biggest problem was Martha. And she's motivated by... I wish everybody would kind of see what I'm doing and either one, help out and be a part of this, or give me some kind of praise or recognition. She needed to be needed. Boy, if that's you, I would encourage you to get over that. Don't need to be needed. Serve because that's what you want to do out of love for your God. Don't serve because you want others to pat you on the back or you need a thank you or something else. Because honestly, you're missing the point of service. Martha was missing, and Jesus says, the main point of being a follower of Christ, that is, spending time with Jesus personally. And so while Martha ignored worship and just plugged into work, Mary, her sister, is simply sitting at Jesus' feet. And so what happened to Martha? She became cumbered with worry and weariness and frustration. Why? Because she's serving self more than the Savior. Mary, on the other hand, finds peace and strength and help. Boy, when I have a high view of myself, I have a very low view of who God is and what He's done in my life, because I'm too busy thinking about me. Romans chapter 8, verse number 6. Again, don't turn there. What worship brings is Romans 8, 6. For to be carnally minded is, anybody know? Death. But to be spiritually minded, having an attitude of love and service and worship to the Savior, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Boy, I would much rather want life and peace than death. So let's understand, the purpose of this place, of this church, is not us as much as it is the Savior. I ought to, first of all, according to Acts chapter number 2 and a multitude of examples in the Bible, our church's purpose ought to be to love God first and foremost. Warren Wiersbe said this, a great commentator, "The local church is espoused to Christ, but there is always the danger of that love growing cold. Like Martha, we can be so busy working for Christ that we have no time to love Him. Christ is more concerned about what we do with Him than for Him. Labor is no substitute for love." So, where is our heart? I think that's a valid question that we ought to ask ourselves. Where is my heart in my service? Is it for me? Is it so that I will get something? Or is my service from my heart truly out of love for my God? And so God says, okay, you want to follow me? You want to show your love? Then you ought to be serving, identifying with your local church. And we said the verse, Hebrews 10, verse number 25, "Not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching." So should we have less church? Should we be less involved in church? No. According to that verse, we should have more. See, I don't get weary from more church services if I'm loving the Lord. I get edified from more church services. I get built up and strengthened by church rather than being strung out and tired from church. And the difference is not God. The difference is me and my heart attitude. How am I approaching Him? Am I loving Him to the point where, boy, I enjoy serving Him. I love it and I look forward to it. And the benefits that He gives to me are not so much tangible, though those might be there, but man, they're eternal and spiritual. Man, those are much better. And so, that's point one. That's purpose one for our church. Let's love God. Let's love God more than anything else. Let's serve Him because we love Him. Not out of some fear or some debt of gratitude we feel or some obligation that we feel, well, I've always done this, I better not quit because then, somebody will be mad at me. Don't serve for that. Serve because you love God. That's a much better motivation. Let's bow for prayer. Lord, please help us to love You.